Welcome back, geologists. I want to start video one for chapter 11 on earthquakes. Let's start by defining what an earthquake is. An earthquake is when ground shaking occurs that is caused by rapid movement of rocks. Rocks slide past one another along what we call faults. And in fact, most earthquakes occur along pre-existing faults. The blocks on either side of the fault are locked due to friction. Once friction overcomes the locked nature of the blocks, then slippage occurs and you have your earthquake. The original place where the rock slips or breaks is called the focus or hypocenter. Both are correct. If you project a point directly above your focus, up to the Earth's surface, that's what we refer to as the epicenter. That's what we hear about reported in the news. The epicenter of an earthquake was located at such and such a place. What happens when breakage occurs along the fault is that energy gets released in the form of seismic waves. These waves radiate out in all directions from the focus. Here's an image. Here's your fault running down here. Here's your one block and the other block. So movement has occurred on either side. So in this case, movement on the right side of the fault has moved down, and the block on the left side of the fault moves up. The place down within the earth where the rock originally breaks, once again, is called the focus or hypocenter. If we project that point directly up to the Earth's surface, that's what we call our epicenter. These are the seismic waves that are emanating out, and all waves carry energy with them. The explanation of how an earthquake occurs is called Rood's elastic rebound theory. Once the rock breaks on either side of the fault, it goes back to its original shape. In that sense, we are rebounding. Here we're looking at displacement along a strike slip fault. You can see that the orchard is offset on either side of the fault. This is an orange grove east of Calexico, California. In this picture, the fault is running between the two fences, so right along here actually, and this distance between the fences is offset by 8.5 feet. This occurred during the 1906 San Francisco earthquake. Let me discuss a little bit more about this elastic rebound theory. Here is a fault in the first picture. So you can picture yourself holding a limber stick. Stress builds up along this fault. And so it begins to bend and it stores elastic energy. So let's bend our stick here a little bit. Once the strength of the rocks is exceeded, slippage along the fault produces the earthquake. So your stick breaks. The rocks return to their original shape, but in a new location, and so that's the rebound effect. So once again, the explanation of how an earthquake occurs is called Rood's elastic rebound theory. After a major earthquake, oftentimes there are many small earthquakes that occur. We call these aftershocks. These will diminish with time. Foreshocks are earthquakes that are small and precede a major earthquake, and in fact may indicate that a larger earthquake is impending. Earthquakes occur along pre-existing faults as well as in new places where differential stresses cause the crust to break. We're going to define three types of what are called dip slip faults, and we talked about this in the previous chapter on crustal deformation. First, we have normal faults associated with divergent plate boundaries, generally not associated with large earthquakes. However, our reverse and thrust faults are associated with convergent plate boundaries and in fact produce some of the most powerful earthquakes on Earth. In a subduction zone, the boundary forms what we refer to as a megathrust fault, and when this breaks, tremendous amounts of energy are released. Third type of fault is our strike slip fault, and these are generally associated with transform plate boundaries, and usually it is a gradual displacement. And ruptures, however, can result in major earthquakes, such as those along the San Andreas fault zone. The most dangerous, the largest earthquakes occur along the megathrust areas on Earth and strike slips. Let's take a look at the megathrust. Here we have a subducting slab of ocean crust subducting beneath a continent. This is your megathrust fault right along here. So this overriding plate, this thrust reverse fault, creates this megathrust situation. Once again, associated with subduction zones and continental collisions. So compression is the type of stress that you have in this situation. As most of us are aware, the San Andreas Fault is very active. And here is a picture of it running from San Francisco all the way down to Southern California. And it shows the Pacific Plate moving in a general northerly direction, with the North American moving in a general southerly direction. So this is a strike slip fault. Let's talk about the fault when it ruptures or breaks and how propagation occurs. Slippage along large faults generally doesn't occur instantaneously. Initially, it begins at the hypocenter, that's down inside the earth, and moves out along the fault surface. The slippage then adds strain to the existing sections. And also slippage mainly travels in one direction. So fault slip is a term we use to describe the amount of displacement on the fault surface. Let's take a look at fault propagation. In this first diagram, during an earthquake, the initial slippage begins at the hypocenter, that's down inside the earth. Here is our fault plane and the rupture surface. In the second picture, the rupture surface begins to move along the fault surface. So here we go. And this rate of movement is about 2 to 3 kilometers per second. Finally, in this last picture, we can see as the rupture surface continues to grow until it reaches a section of the fault, right here, section of the fault, where the rocks have not been sufficiently strained to be broken, and the earthquake stops. Seismology is the branch of geology that studies earthquakes. The Chinese were studying earthquakes over 2,000 years ago. Let's take a look at what their seismograph looked like. This is the ancient Chinese seismograph. When the ground began to shake, depending on what direction that shake was coming from, a ball would drop out of the dragon's mouth and into a waiting frog. So seismographs are the actual machine that records the earthquake. And it is based on the principle of inertia. When an earthquake occurs, you can get vertical as well as horizontal movement of the ground. So you need two different types of seismographs. to differentiate between ground motion. Let's take a look at these. In this image, we have a seismograph that is measuring horizontal motion. The idea is that this weight here does not move, okay? The machine is supported and vibrates back and forth, and then this object here, and this is the inertia part, stays still and everything else moves around it. This seismograph measures vertical ground motion. So here's our suspended weight. The idea is it's at rest, it stays at rest, that's inertia. And the mechanism moves up and down. The spring keeps this steady, and this rotating drum records the seismic waves. I'm going to stop my recording here. We will talk about the different types of seismic waves in our next video. So this concludes video 1, chapter 11 on earthquakes.